Today we have a piano repair courtesy of some movers. They banged us into something when it got away from them, and it took out about a 24-inch section of the back rim. Really crushed it good. It went in so far that on the inside, where the nut is that holds the plate down, the back of this board was pushed in far enough to actually put a dent in that, and it sprung back to this position here. The wood's pretty chewed up and pretty frayed. Originally, I thought we could just perhaps kind of pull it back together and then take the edges out, glue them in, put them back together. But the wood was so splintered and frayed and out of shape that we had to cut it apart, take that section out, and then refit the ends before we put it back together. Okay, we used a rotary cutter with a carbide, 2-inch carbide blade in it for cutting the relief cuts to get the section out. And even though we know that, you can still see where the wood just doesn't want to go back into shape even after the releases are done. You can see where the registration mark is on the wood, how far out that is. That's probably 1/2 inch as far as being bent out. So we're going to have to clamp both edges of the top back in, and also both edges of the piece that came out, glue all the frayed stuff back together. And to do that, we're going to use some hide glue because it has a good strong bond. It's great for getting down in little thin spots because it's a little bit more runny than your yellow glue. You have to be a little careful with the clamping. This is a curved surface, so you don't want to squish things and make it a flat edge there. So you do a little adjustment with your clamps and your blocks to get them to fit. We've got wax paper in between to keep it from sticking. And then you don't want to draw it down super duper tight either. You want to get it, just draw it into where it needs to be and then let it dry in that position. If you over clamp it, you'll get some dents and things you're going to have to fill later on. And also misshaping the edge. We want a nice smooth arch going all the way across. So we don't want to put flats on the end of where we're gluing here by over clamping these things. Okay, once again, we're trying to get all the fibers glued down, all the edges. The edge band is made up of laminates of veneer plus solid core inside. So wherever the veneer is loosened on the inside and outside, we want to make sure we get all that glued down. You don't want any little bubbles or spots where it's not going to be tight. Otherwise, it can actually cause some buzzing or in the piano when you start to play it, if you have a hollow spot there or a place where it's not glued down. We're squishing it down, make sure we got enough in there so you make sure it oozes out. Take a little wedge, cram it in there, whatever you need to do, so that you can get the glue all the way down and all the way back around the edge. Pick up a little extra, it fell off, reusing it. Sometimes it's necessary to take something off so you get it to where you need to glue. It's important, again, to get everything glued. If the cap was still left on, there's no way you can get the glue down there, so the cap had to be removed to do that. To aid in getting the glue down inside cracks and crevices, we have some little brass thin shims picked up in a bunch of junk at an auction somewhere. They really make great tools for working that glue down in little cracks and crevices. And what's nice about it is when using water-based glues like your PVAs and also your hide glue, you can just soak these things in water and it gets all the glue off and you can go back and reuse it again. But it's good, remember, you got to get that stuff way down in there, get all the fibers glued together. Now we're not trying to glue the edge, only the veneer where it's coming apart. We'll glue the edges later with the epoxy when we set it in place. So you don't want to get a lot of glue on your edges there, because you want to be able to have a good bond. You don't want the wood sealed off. Now that the edges are all glued down, we make a little jig here to fashion in or set in place the missing section. And we're using some 2x4s that are fairly rigid, so when you clamp it in place, it'll stay that form. It won't go around the edges any. And once again, we got the wax paper to keep things from getting stuck where you don't want. And we also put a little piece of tape around the bottom so the glue won't ooze out and then run down in behind the piano. So down on the soundboard, we don't want any glue down in there. And we're going to put a pretty liberal amount so we You got to have something there to keep from oozing in there. And as you see the dowels, there's a little trick you can do with the dowels is to drill your hole just a little bit bigger than your dowel itself. And then when you set the dowels in place, it has some wiggle room, so you don't have to be so precise in getting the holes drilled perfectly aligned, because the glue itself and the wood make a composite material which is stronger than the wood or the glue separately. And you see a little notch we've also cut across the bottom of the piece and also the bottom of the piano. And what that does is it's going to act like a big long biscuit. Once the glue is hardened, it'll fill that gap in. It'll make a long ridge, a spline that'll hold everything together, be pretty strong. All right, now this epoxy that we're using here is a West Systems, and it comes with a hardener which is fast, slow, and extra slow. When you're gluing wood, one thing you can think about is the amount of working time you have to put it together, so you want to adjust it for that. But also, the slower the glue dries, the longer time it has for it to absorb into the fibers, and actually makes a stronger bond once it finally cures. So a lot of times I only use the fast if it's some kind of a quick project you want to get done, little piece. But when you're doing something large like this, you want the slow or even the extra slow to do it. And you're going to wet all the edges really good, just with the glue by itself, before putting in that filler in it, and allow it plenty of time to absorb into the wood and soak in. If you opt not to do that, one of the things that can happen is that if you have very porous wood, as you glue it together, the joint on either side of the wood will absorb and suck up all the glue, not leaving enough glue in the joint itself to actually hold it. The wood just sucks it up like a sponge, and then you're kind of stuck. Now we're going to add some, after we've got it all wet and wetted down, now we're going to add the filler into it. And the filler comes also in a couple different kinds. There's stuff for bonding hardware, there's stuff for filling gaps, there's stuff for laminating, so choose the appropriate filler. Now, to make it the dowels fit tight and everything you go in the groove, we mix it up kind of like a thickness of about like a little bit of a thin peanut butter. It gives it plenty of wetness to still absorb in. It gives it a lot of filling ability, and it'll stand rigid up there. So you're going to go back now that you've got everything wetted down, go back and add it in with the filler, and you see how thick this is. This will fill in any gaps that are missing, where you've cut the fibers on the bottom and also the difference in the diameter of the dowel sizes. It'll fill in all the little gaps and make it a really nice solid glue joint. West Systems is a pretty good epoxy for doing this type of material. It has a lot of different applications. You can do it, and you can get it. Most any marine place has it around, so it's very widely available. You want to make sure that you get a lot of extra glue down in there, any spot where there might be a gap, because the glue itself with the filler will act like a strong putty even, and it will rebuild any missing gaps a lot stronger than the wood or the glue by itself. And so you don't have enough in there, you want to add extra wherever there's a gap, or like around the dowels where you need you made that extra room. It's also nice to have a helper when you're doing this. Remember that the epoxy is time sensitive as far as getting it in there before it hardens on you. So an extra set of hands that comes in helpful when you have a big, large piece like this to keep it from getting all the glue stuck on your fingers and everything. And again, you want to really fill it in and paste in any places where there's, put in extra where there's going to be potential gaps or crack, or where there's not a good fit, where the wood didn't go together really good. You want to put in enough glue or guesstimate how much extra you got to put in, that is, to get a good squeeze out when it's finished. You don't want to put too much in and get too much squeezing out, because then you got a big mess to clean up. But you do want to have some squeeze out to ensure that you've got all the gaps filled when you're putting it together. And I think when you see this go in, you'll watch that bottom edge there. You'll see the extra glue squeezing out as we press it, once we get it in shape and press it down. There you can see it squeezing out. It's good to do a dry fitting of your pieces sometimes before you put them all, clamp it all together, just to make sure things are going to go together right and you already have your clamps ready and your blocks ready where they're going to go. If you're experienced sometimes and you know what you're doing, you can do it on the fly, but you got to watch out, you don't get caught and wish you had more time later on. So it depends what your skill level is. You can either pre-clamp or not. But this is going to require a horizontal and vertical clamping to squeeze the broken out section down to the base of the piano, and also the vertical section going back and forth on those bars that we installed to keep the thing parallel with the outside edge of the piano. Now, so remember, when you're clamping with epoxy, it's not necessary to get a real hard squeeze on it. One thing you're trying to do here is get the pieces lined up to where they need to be lined up. You don't have to put a lot of pressure on the joints like you do with PVA type glues. Once you've got the pieces all lined up where they're supposed to be, you can let it go. If you could set it in place and let it harden without clamps, you can do that too. But clamping a lot of times is necessary on something like this where it's been misshapen and out of shape. You got to bend it a little bit into shape to get it, everything to line up just right. And once you do, you can just let it dry. And we generally let this stuff dry over like overnight before we take the clamps off. Once the glue is dry and take the clamps off, it's time to fill in all the gaps. We use a Bondo type material, which is a fiberglass putty, for strength and for smoothness and for quick drying and ease of working. And it doesn't come up too many little pinholes. We also, after you get it filled, you can see where we hit this a couple times to even it out. There's a couple low spots or high spots. And then we use a real fine putty, which is like a glaze type of material, to go over it, as you see here, filling any little pinholes and things. And then once it's all sanded down and nice and smooth, the next step is basically, we started with the outside by putting just a coat of black primer. Recoloring the inside is a four-step process where you first put your base color down to get the background in it. Then you go back over it with a graining pencil, or we use what's called a China marker to draw the grain in. If you have watched our previous videos on spot touch-up, it talks pretty much in depth about that. You see the China marker laying there in the foreground. But once you get the base color on and then the graining done, put a sealer coat on it, and then the next step would be we use a glaze to give it more of a natural wood toning, as you see here. And then after that, you put a clear coat on top to match the sheen, and you're done with the inside. Comes out looking very natural. When done correctly, the touch-up, when complete, is virtually undetectable by anybody who hasn't seen the damage. If you saw it and you look carefully, you might be able to see it, but most people can't. On the outside now, we've got the final coats. We put one coat of straight black on it, and after the primer, then we put sand it down, put a second coat of black, and then for the final coat, we used the black plus clear, and comes out looking exactly like the rest of the piano. It's a little smoother than originally because it was not a brand new finish on there. And we sprayed it out to the breaking points of the apex of the curve on each side, so as you come around you won't detect where we did the stop and start on the spraying. Plus we kind of compounded it out to feather it in. So when it's all finished, you got basically a piano that doesn't look like it was ever damaged.